Thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you will notice that there's a different witness in front of you right now. And I'm going to instruct you at this time, you are to disregard the testimony of the last witness, if you'll swear this witness for us.
And we are back, and we are back. Thank you all for watching this video. Go ahead, touch, tap, or otherwise get involved with that like button as we get into what happened today after lunch in court. Y'all, today has continued to be a very strange day at court. As you can see from the first clip, the coming up clip, the prosecution went through part of the testimony of a witness only to have a bench, an approach, a come hither called with the judge. And then after that, the defense actually argued successfully to have that entire testimony just erased. So y'all are going to see this. Y'all are going to see love seething. You're going to see how she can't let go, but she also knows that she shouldn't push Judge Whitaker. Judge Whitaker has told her before, Miss Love, don't argue with me. I've made my ruling. So you're going to see how uncomfortable Love gets as she's losing. And she did lose on this particular issue. And then after that, I blurred out the detective or the officer's face, but then Love introduces her next witness. He's supposed to be undercover, I guess, but she introduces him without telling the cameraman not to record him. So he gets his face all put on blast. I blurred it out because, of course, he did not want to be shown on camera. So just a really interesting day today. I definitely do think it's worth the watch. You already know this testimony from this witness who winds up having her testimony erased. It's a little slow, but sit through it. You know, put it on 1.5 or 1.75 to get through it. That way you'll know what was said when you hear all of the argumentation afterwards, and you'll see what Love is arguing. So without further ado, again, thank you all. Don't forget to like, do comment, do subscribe, and let's get into it. Oh yeah, one more thing. And this clip here, this first clip you're gonna see is the follow-up from the previous video where Quindarius Zachary's attorney is arguing to let him out of jail, to let him out of the hospital. When it's time, let him go home, await his testimony. So Judge Whitaker wanted to hear, what did the doctor say? So remember, they sent an investigator with Quindarius's lawyer yesterday. And so the judge wanted to hear the report back from the investigator. So the first thing you're going to see here is the judge questioning the investigator, and then we'll continue on.
This would adversely impact Mr. Zachary to the extent that the doctor had concerns about, you know, a rapidly deteriorating medical condition. Okay. Was it discussed?
It was discussed. Discussed about his the medication that he was on. Mr. Shai actually specifically asked if the medication would affect his mental state of mind and his ability to understand. The doctor said no.
Okay. Okay. And nothing about he or she had no concerns about stress being able to.
No.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I appreciate your time. All right, Ms. Love, during this lunch break, please get that information to the defense. If you want to just email it to everybody.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
Okay. LaShantis Porter, LaShantise, last name Porter, Porter.
Ms. Porter, good afternoon.
Hey, how are you?
Ms. Porter, did you change your name? Did your name change?
Yes.
And what did you go by formally?
Hill.
Where do you currently work, Ms. Porter?
Atlanta Police Crime Scene Unit.
And how long have you worked for APD?
For 19 years.
Can you tell the jury what your current role is?
I am a crime scene director for the Atlanta Police Department.
Okay. And what are some of your responsibilities in that role?
I ensure that the crime scene technicians are doing their jobs properly, processing evidence properly, collecting evidence properly. I also manage our customer service section where they do background checks.
And how long have you been in that role?
For 3 months.
In 2014, Yeah, in 2014, what was your position?
A senior crime scene technician.
And what were some of your responsibilities as a senior crime scene technician?
Responding to crime scene calls, processing evidence, and assisting with training new hires.
Now, it's kind of important to distinguish. Are you a member of law enforcement?
Yes. However, I'm a civilian employee.
Are you post-certified?
Yes, I am.
Now, Director Porter, I want to draw your attention to December 26, 2014. Were you working that day?
Yes.
And on that day, how long had you been working as a senior crime scene technician?
I believe about 2 to 3 years.
And were you on shifts or on call?
We were on shifts at the time.
And what was your shift?
I was 4 p.m. to 12 a.m.
Were you alone or with a partner?
I was alone.
So on December 26, 2014, were you dispatched to a shooting scene at 1097 Harwell Road, Southwest?
Yes.
Now, was this a business or a residential area?
It was a business.
What business?
The Blue Flame.
Have you been to this business before?
At this time, I'm not sure if I had.
Is this business located in Fulton County?
Yes.
Do you know what time you were dispatched?
I was dispatched at 9:29 p.m.
Now, what was your job when you arrived on scene?
My job was to process the scene by taking photos and collecting the evidence that needed to be collected.
Now, is there a difference between searching for evidence and collecting evidence?
Yes.
What is that difference?
So if you're searching for evidence, you're combing the scene, looking for items of evidentiary value. Collecting, you have located those items and you are now collecting them for processing and submissions.
Did you search for any evidence in this case?
No, I didn't.
Did you collect any evidence in this case?
Yes.
What did you collect?
I collected 7 shell casings.
And where did you collect these shell casings from?
The shell cases were located in the parking lot of the business.
Of the Blue Flame?
Yes.
Did you happen to take any photographs?
Yes, I did.
About how many photographs did you take?
I took 63 photographs. Repeat the question.
Do you recall where you actually took photographs that night?
They were toward the bottom, maybe toward the street of the parking lot.
And the shell casings that you collected, were they all of the same type?
No.
Did you take any prints from the casings?
The casings were processed for prints, but there were none of value lifted.
What did you do with the shell casings you did collect?
Once they were collected and processed, they were submitted to our APD crime lab for ballistics analysis.
Did you perform any ballistics testing?
No.
Now, what did you do with the photographs?
The photographs were placed on a disc and sent to our photo lab.
Do you recall the case number of this particular incident?
No, I don't.
When looking at your report help refresh your memory?
Yes.
Your Honor, permission to approach?
Yes.
And what was that case number?
It was 14-360-2137.
Okay. Now, would your crime scene report have the same report number as the APD report number?
Yes.
I am now showing you what's been marked as 33 Delta, Delta, Delta through 96 Delta, Delta, Delta. Permission to approach, Your Honor?
You may.
And these have been previously served. Your Honor, may we approach?
Yes. So there's a relevance objection to essentially, I guess, all of what the witness might be about to testify to. And Mr. Smith, you were trying to sort of explain the relevance, and if you can just do it here.
Your Honor, these shell casings that were collected at 1097 Harwell Road. This location is just down the street from Club Crucial. It happened December 26, 2014, and it produced a Niven hit to 2905 Springdale Road, which occurred on January 28, 2015, one of the other cases that the state has presented evidence on.
Okay, and?
And so, Your Honor, it as we're talking about the shootings and the violence that has occurred throughout this investigation, the shell casings, the fact that there is this Niven hit, it just shows various locations. We're not going to say this person had it in their hands, but the fact that there are Niven hits to locations that are in close proximity to locations where we know where we... Where...
I have no idea why it's doing that.
Testing. Where we know that other instances that have involved the groups of people that are an interest in this gang war have been seen and apprehended at, we believe that it's relevant because it tends to show that this particular firearm was used in at more than one location and more than one incident. So the connection of the locations by shell casings, it's not like it's 2 years earlier or two. Or 20 miles away, the proximity and temporal proximity of the locations are what we believe make it relevant.
All right, and which group is it that is alleged to, that you, the state's theory at least, committed this? So, you said Springdale Road in this?
Yes, yeah, so 2905 Springdale Road, yes, on January the 28th. Which was,
right.
And Your Honor, we are not going to always in each case be able to say this okay. person had this gun.
Right, but I mean, was this alleged to be two YSL shootings no, or?
The 2905 Springdale Road, just mm-hmm. 1 second, was. January 28th was the location of Miss Antrevia Antrevia is the location of one of the witnesses that we have.
The Springdale Road?
Yes.
Right. And who is alleged to, or which group is alleged to have committed that shooting?
There was, during interviews, there was an allegation. The groups that were alleged to have been involved were the groups that are listed, YSL and IF Gang. But okay. I cannot say.
For the Blue Flame and then for Springdale Road, is YSL the group alleged to have committed those shootings?
Not for Blue Flame, we don't know. But the Springdale Road, there was an allegation that YSL committed the Springdale Road shooting.
Okay.
We don't know who committed the Blue Flame, but we do know that the shell casings that were at Springdale Road were also fired at the, they are producing NIBA matches to a location just a mile away from Club Crucial, in the latter part of December 2014.
All right, and is this Club Crucial, or not, I'm sorry, is this Blue Flame shooting anywhere in the indictment?
No, it's not that it's in the indictment. It's just that the... It's the the proliferation of violence and the location of the amount of violence caused by these weapons that have been used in these various shootings, we believe is relevant.
Okay. And is the weapon that matches both of these also, was it found in the possession of anybody who's alleged to be a YSL co-conspirator?
No. Let me make sure about that. Hang on.
Do y'all even have the weapon that these two things match?
No, we don't have the weapon. We have shell casings, but not the gun in this particular case. And so we don't, and we're in showing the back and forths, we're showing the amount of shootings.
Okay. So I know that for a lot of the different incidents, there is a theory that, you know, there is one shooting by one gang against another, and then the other gang retaliates against the first gang, right, and it goes back and forth, back and forth.
Right.
Is the Blue Flame shooting alleged to have been any part of that back and forth, back and forth?
We don't have that. We don't, in as much as we don't know who committed that, all that we know is that the weapons used there were knife and hits to.
Okay. So you just want to show that I assume we'll have some evidence that in some way ties YSL to the Springdale Road shooting, and you want to be able to show that somebody involved in that might have been involved in some other shooting, just to show that they shoot things up a lot, essentially.
Well, the count one of this indictment alleges exactly that.
Okay, but this isn't an overt act in count one of the indictment, right?
No, but it's proof, it's not an overt act. No, the Blue Flame, no. But it is, I guess our position is it doesn't need to be an overact to be proof of something that we are showing.
Has there been any prior notice about this? Any argument that it's 404B or intrinsic?
Well, we have not.
Yes or no?
No, I don't think we have. No.
All right. I'm going to sustain that relevance objection.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm going to exclude it based on relevance, 403, lack of notice.
Your Honor,
ma'am.
Well, Your Honor, inasmuch as it has produced a NIBIN hit and that they have known, we have provided that information from day one. This is not something that has been kept. And inasmuch as it is a firearm that has been used in a shooting that we believe was committed by and perpetrated by one of the, or at least a member or associate of the enterprise that we're talking about for a reason that.
Okay. Well, I asked you if you had anything that tied this gun to a particular YSL co-conspirator, and you said no.
I'm sorry, but we said that 2905 Springdale Road is a location that we have heard from interviews that a YSL person shot up. We don't have a particular YSL person. And the fact that that same firearm was used less than a month, I mean, about a month earlier at a location about a mile away from where other YSL shootings occurred, we believe that makes it intrinsic. We've not argued, the court asked us had we argued that. We have not argued it, no. But we do believe that it's intrinsic, it's definitely relevant. The jury could draw the conclusion that this same firearm was used in a different location. It would then be part of the evidence showing the nature of the enterprise that is described and alleged in count one. So in as much as the relevance, we believe, is that this firearm that we believe was used by a YSL member is used in another location, showing the level of the type of violence, showing the nature of the acts committed by the enterprise, we believe that it certainly meets the very, very, very low burden of relevance, and we believe it meets it. It's more than, you know, the small burden required to be relevant.
Okay. Well, maybe relevance wasn't the right.
And in as much as it's intrinsic, there's not notice that's required for intrinsic evidence. Evidence is just proving an element of count one. So there's no 404B analysis. There's nothing that has been argued or that suggests that somehow this would cause the jury to convict either of the defendants on grounds other than those alleged in the indictment. So we believe that it's relevant, pertinent, intrinsic, and admissible, and should not be subject to that extreme sanction of exclusion, given that this is something that has been, this particular NIBIN match, this particular information has been made known to the defense since the beginning of this case back in 2022. So we would ask that the court not exclude this information. And this is not a witness that is going to take a very long time. We have two photographs that we're going to publish. We have, I think, about maybe 30 that she took, but two that 60 that she took, but third two that we were going to publish.
All right. Well, maybe I misunderstood a little bit about what Mr. Smith was saying at the bench. It sounded, and that may be my fault. I thought he was saying the NIBIN match was something that just got learned this week.
No.
So that was my misunderstanding. No. Maybe you just meant, I don't know what you meant. So you said something about things that had just occurred this week.
Well, we just put these witnesses back on the list.
Okay. So I'll hear from the defense.
Your Honor.
Yes, sir.
Well, first of all, there's a lot of irrelevant police reports that are included in discovery.
Talk into your mic, please.
There are many, many irrelevant police reports and irrelevant incidents that are included in discovery. So just because the state put in discovery and we didn't jump up and down doesn't all of a sudden make something relevant or past 403. Your Honor, what the state is not telling you, and quite honestly, I don't think they're being a little misleading. The 2905 Springdale Road address.
Yes.
That's in Trivia Smith's house. No one was ever charged with that. There's no solid evidence whatsoever. The state wants to say, oh, well, we believe YSL is involved. They didn't say a name. They didn't say anyone that's allegedly did the shooting. They have no idea. And, you know, they also know from the discovery, if we're being honest about it, there's several references to Shell Kell shooting up 2905 Springdale Road. Nothing's funny about this. And the reality is They have no clue. The police have no clue. No one was charged with it. And now they want to bring in a separate incident that involves a man. It appears from me reading the police report, a man, Mr. Strozier, who's targeted outside Blue Flame, waiting on his wife to cash out. It's probably a robbery. Mr. Strozier has no relation that I know of to either YSL or If Gang or anything else that would suggest this is a back and forth shooting between the two groups. This has nothing to do with anything.
Your Honor, if I may respond briefly. Contrary to the belief, I guess, by counsel for defendant Stillwell regarding the information that we provided to the court heard me say, and I maintained what address was at that location. I started to say the name and then I chose not to say all of it, but it is alleged at that time that she had begun seeing Kelvin Watts. And this is the precipitation of the providing of that video where we see Antonio Sledge and Quindarius Zachary saying we ain't going back and forth. She provided this to the police after this shooting, right? After this shooting. That's how she interfaced with Detective Dennis. So while a member of YSL, I think Mr. Zachary said something to the effect of, you know, well, somebody said Shell Kell shot it up. But at the time that this shooting happened, she was dating Mr. Watts. And so there was, you know, it was said sort of sheepishly, the court can hear it, it'll come in, I believe, during other testimony. But the idea that I'm certain there would be a desire that everything that we put in here is considered irrelevant, but it's not, simply because an assertion is made by, you know, one of the accused that it's not relevant. It is in fact relevant. It does not, there's nothing that warrants its exclusion. It meets the very low requirement for relevance, and arguments to the contrary don't take into account the information I believe we've just shared with the court. So no one has ever said anything about the victim in this case. We're not bringing up his name. We're not trying to say he has anything to do with it. But guess what? A lot of the other shootings that occurred, for instance, the location of Miss B, she wasn't a intended target. And that's the whole, that's one of the themes here. We see people who aren't intended targets getting affected by the violence that's perpetrated by persons on behalf of this enterprise. And so in as much as that person's name, you know.
Do you have any evidence that the shooting at the Blue Flame was perpetrated on behalf of, at the direction of YSL?
Your Honor, what the evidence that we have that we believe suggests that a member of YSL was involved in that, okay, is a Niven hit.
Right. To the, okay. A member of YSL was involved in that is not the same as it was done at the direction of, in furtherance of YSL.
And Your Honor,
so
I get that.
All you have is that the gun used here
produced
is suspected to have, was apparently the same gun used at the Springdale Road location, which is suspected to have been done by a YSL member, but could equally have been done by somebody who's not YSL, under the theory that, I mean,
Your Honor, it's circumstantial
theory, evidence.
Right?
It is circumstantial evidence.
It is.
All right. Right. And I mean, yes, you can prove your case based on circumstantial evidence. You have a right to do that. But I do not find that this Blue Flame incident is intrinsic to the issues in this indictment. So I am excluding it. All right. So does that mean that we're done with this witness?
Your Honor, if the court's going to exclude that one, then we'll.
Your Honor, could we just have an instruction to the jury to just strike the testimony about this incident?
Well, they hadn't heard much of anything yet anyway, right. But yes. All right.
Your Honor.
Yes.
Your Honor, I would ask that, given that the court has decided that it has not heard very much, there's nothing that's prejudicial to anyone that's been presented. We would ask that the court simply allow the state to have no further questions and move forward. They haven't even seen the photographs. And so to strike the information, there's nothing that has been in any way that could, you know, they because it are harmful. So we'd ask that.
Well, it's not harmful, but I mean, we don't want to be confusing the jury, so I'll just tell them to disregard it. You can certainly put her back on the stand and say, thank you, no further questions, but then I'm going to turn around and say, disregard all that testimony. Yeah. If you want me to say it in a way that you want to come up with a particular way for me to potentially say it, I'm willing to consider it.
Just one moment, Your Honor. Okay. The court will allow
anybody
us.
Need to use the restroom while we're on break anyway? Yes. Okay. Your Think Honor. About it. Well, let's try to take. Yes, sir.
And when you come back, or can do it now.
We can do it now.
Thank you, Judge. Your Honor, the court asked me some questions regarding any objections I have to a 911 call.
Yes.
I'd like to be heard at the court's pleasure.
Yeah, that's fine if we want to do that now.
We want to
break
craft
and then,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Okay. We'll break. We'll do the crafting of the instruction. We'll take the 911 issue up. You can let the jury know it'll be at least 15 more minutes. All right, y'all try to get back here quickly so we can deal with these issues. Defense gotten a chance to look. Does anybody have any suggestions? One thing that I have a concern with about it is just the use of the word we.
Removing the court is removed. Well, I don't know what we state. So what is the we?
Is that the one in green?
So yeah, that's the one in green, Your Honor. Would the court mind advising when the court says the problem is with the word we? I don't have a problem with any pronoun. The state, the court. I don't know. This court is removing.
I haven't gotten anything from y'all, Mr. Steele, and it may be that you just sent it to Ms. Pursefield, and she'll be in here in just a minute. But you want to just tell me what it is?
Yeah.
Your Honor, reads, ladies and gentlemen, you are hereby ordered to disregard in its entirety the testimony of the last witness. State may call its next witness.
Okay. I mean, I was just going to say you were to disregard the testimony of the last witness, but I understand if you want some sort of a reason why, but it's not.
Your Honor, if I may, the other thing is, Your Honor, the court asked us specific questions, and I understand that what the court's ruling is regarding relevance and the admissibility of that evidence. We asked in the second email to the court that it was just a follow-up. It was the same thing. It was just a follow-up with a parenthetical at the bottom that the court allowed, should the state have additional information to present to the court regarding this matter, that we may ask for reconsideration. And that is the only reason that I asked that the court tell the jury that the court, whoever the court wishes, it's being removed. The evidence of incident 1-4.
Had she already said the incident number?
I believe she had. Didn't you have? She had. That is all that she had said. I think she did. She say? Yeah, she had said the incident number and location. She had never said a person's name, and we had not shown or published any photographs.
All right, I'll hear from anybody as to this.
Your Honor. I just would like the instruction that we gave or asked for in writing. If you don't have it, it's what I read out. And
I'm just going to say at this time, you're to disregard the testimony of the last witness.
Okay.
That way the at this time's in there, and if it comes up later, great.
And the bigger problem with this is the state is saying we have evidence from somebody that they never disclosed to us. We've asked for expert reports. We've gotten zero. And that's been the problem the whole time.
I'm confused now about what you're talking about. Okay. Evidence of what? Evidence that a YSL member committed the Springdale?
Yeah. So it's
thing. Well, it's, I don't know that that would be an expert.
Well, what they're saying is gang experts go out and interview people, but we don't have any of those interviews. So we're just, you know, trusting the word of Miss Love. And that happens all the time because we don't get an expert report by saying, why is the blue flame linked to this crime? Besides just a random hit on a computer database. But that's besides the point. I understand we have a jury. We don't want it to read the incident. It sounds like the court is saying that it happened. It has something to do with this case. We just want to say disregard the witness's testimony. The state can call its next witness.
All right. Let's get the jury out. Oh, gosh. Oh. You're right. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah.
Short attention span sometimes. Was there something else on this, Ms. Love, before we move to the 911?
No, Your Honor. The court intends to get the instruction.
I'm just going to say at this time you're to disregard the testimony of the last witness.
Thank you. And whenever Mr. Matthews right. has his.
So, Judge, good afternoon. There's a 911 call that is going to be planned to be introduced by the state. Mm-hmm. It's from a March 12th, 2020, theft of a vehicle call. Your Honor, I have had an opportunity to listen to the 911 call. And based on the 911 call, Your Honor, it's our position that that call is a testimonial call that would be excluded under the confrontation clause.
Listen to it. Do you know how long after?
It's about a minute or two.
Oh, no,
minutes.
I meant how long after the incident it came in?
How long after? Oh, yes. So according to the 911 call, it was the caller said that over an hour ago, the theft took place.
All right. I'll take a listen.
Okay.
If somebody can cue that up for me.
Okay. While they're queuing it up, Your Honor, I would submit that when you listen to the call, it's not going to indicate that it's thwarting an ongoing crime. It's not going to be to seek any assistance in any situation involving immediate danger. And the callers, Chandler Durham or this other person, hasn't been called as a witness. We've never had an opportunity to cross-examine this person at any prior proceedings or anything of that nature. So this will be the first time. So that's what makes it, in our opinion, testimonial. And the cases that I'd like to cite for the court is going to be two cases, Pitts versus the State, 280 Georgia, 288. That's an 06 case. It's been cited several times. It was one of the recent sightings on it was McCord versus the State, 305 Georgia, 318. It's a 2019 case.
Right.
This is not a present sense impression call that you're about to hear, in our opinion.
Mr. Atkins is queuing that up for the court.
Thank you.
Atlanta 911, I've heard of 7434. What's the location of your emergency?
500 Bishop Street.
500 Bishop Street, you need police, fire, and ambulance.
Sweet C.
Sweet C, you need police, fire, and ambulance.
I can't hear you.
Do you need police, fire, or an ambulance?
Police.
And that's Sweet C, Charlie?
Say that again?
It's Sweet letter C, Charlie?
Yeah, Sweet letter C as in Charlie, yeah.
Okay. Is this a business, a house, apartment?
It's a business.
What's the name of it?
Sonica.
Sonica, okay. And what's going on at Sonica? Why you need an officer?
Stolen car.
Your car was stolen from this location?
Yeah, but not my car. One of my clients' car was stolen.
Okay. What color is the vehicle?
It's a black vehicle.
Is the owner of the vehicle there?
Yes, he is.
Okay. Can you ask him what year it is?
It's 2019.
And what type of car is it?
It's a Dodge a Hellcat Red Eye.
So is that a Challenger or a Charger?
Challenger.
You said Hellcat?
Yes.
Okay, do we have the tag number available?
Oh, 1 second.
Do Do we have a description of the person who took the vehicle?
No, I don't.
When was it taken? Today?
Yeah, about 30 minutes ago. What time it is? So about an hour. I guess it's been about an hour. I guess a little over an hour.
This is your first time calling?
Yep.
Okay. The vehicle owner, what's that person's name?
Hello?
Yes, it's Atlanta 911. Yes. May I have your name?
My name is Chandler. First name Chandler, last name Durham. D-U-R-H-A-M.
Okay, Mr. Durham, what's your phone number?
404-502-2953.
That's 404-502-2953?
Yeah.
And so the officer knows it's you. Tell me what you're wearing. What color shirt and pants?
I have on a black hoodie and green sweatpants.
Black hoodie, green sweatpants. Are you a black, white, Hispanic, or Asian male?
Black.
And will you be inside or outside of the location?
I'm outside.
Okay. And do you have the tag number to your vehicle?
Yeah, I'm trying to find it.
And is it registered in the state of Georgia?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not sure.
Do you see the VIN number? You have a VIN number?
Let me look on my insurance. I might have a VIN number. See if I can find my card. No, I don't have a VIN number.
Okay. So by the time the officer arrives, you'll need the VIN number or the tag number. I would advise you to go ahead and call your insurance company and ask them for it because they'll be able to give it to you.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
All right.
So, Your Honor, the caller initially says, I don't know if the court heard it, but I heard it, says, need a police report. It's number one. There were two callers on the call. One was the owner of the business. The second one was the victim of the theft of the vehicle. And that description that the court heard, that was the description of Chandler Durham, who says, right, I have on a black hoodie, I'll be outside, so
seems
forth.
Seems like they switched the phone over.
They switched the phone over.
A few minutes to say, for him to give the details.
Right. And Durham says, hey, I have a black hoodie on, green pants. I'll be outside when the police get there. So the police get there and then they do some further questioning. So in our based on the law, Your Honor, this is a testimonial call. It doesn't involve a present sense impression, Your Honor. The court heard the call. And it was over an hour after the theft of the vehicle, so it's not to thwart an ongoing crime, and it's not to seek any assistance in a situation involving immediate danger. They don't know who took the car. They have no other information other than the car is gone when they discover it. So they call in to make a report, have a police officer come out there. Thank you, Judge.
I hear from the state.
Yes, Judge. Your Honor, clearly this call was made to report the theft of this person's property. He's not trying to implicate anyone, to get anyone in any trouble for any kind of litigation. He's trying to get his car back. And the only thing that he's describing, I believe in all of the cases that we've looked at to, or at least previously with the court's predecessor, when the court was evaluating whether or not it considered a call to be testimonial, and for the purposes of future litigation, it involved a situation where, for instance, someone called to report not an ongoing emergency, but, you know, he's violating his probation or something like that. In this case, Judge, the man's car had just gotten stolen. Even if maybe he had to walk around the parking lot for an hour, he, you know, is really gone. But the fact remains, it was gone and he was trying to get it back. He didn't give anyone's description but his own. And he's telling them, I'll be out here waiting on you. So I don't believe that this falls into the category of testimonial. And we believe that it should be admitted, Your Honor.
All right. Do you have any case law about, because it's not
to report a crime in progress. The crime already occurred. And it maybe, I mean, we don't know whether they just discovered it, even though it occurred in 30 minutes to an hour ago or not. We don't have that information, but it's not a crime in progress and it's not to avert immediate danger. It still also may not be something that anybody objectively would know would be used in a future prosecution. They don't seem to be saying, we think it was, you know, the big bad wolf who stole my car. We're just saying, my car's gone. So do you have anything that covers that kind of a situation in case law?
Your Honor, I can be with the court's permission, getting it while we're okay. Putting up other pieces of
evidence. All right, she's so not our next witness anyway, right? Ms. Lattner's starting. Okay.
Right.
All right. I will, understanding what the issue is, get back to y'all with a ruling before she takes the stand.
Thank you.
Okay. So do you have your next witness available?
Yes.
All right. Let's get the jury out.
Your Honor, while the jury's coming in, can you just also, I just want to put on the record, because you excluded that last witness,
uh-huh.
That's also on the Nibin chart, if that could be removed by the state.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's not in evidence yet, right? A Nibin chart?
No, we put a Nibin chart in evidence.
Are you going to ever?
No. Not that includes something that the court excluded. Nope.
Okay, well, make sure that it gets removed from the chart, even if the chart gets used as a demonstrative.
Yes,
Thank
Your
you
Honor.
For bringing that to our attention.
Yes, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you. Ready for the jury. I'm sorry. Hold just a second. We need the witness to be excused again. Can we ask you to step back out for a second?
Yes.
Oh, well, but stay really close because we might need you in here again. Just stand at the door for us. Yes, sir.
Yes, Your Honor. We're requesting that the witness not be filmed in the undercover capacity.
Okay, is there any issue with that? I don't know.
Detective Starks?
Y'all come on up here. Yes. Yeah, that's what I figured, is that nobody said that before he walked in as the next witness. So, and honestly, y'all, even like, y'all keep skipping around. You will tell everybody it's going to be witnesses A, B, C, D, and E. And then it's witness A, witness E, witness D, witness B. I mean, y'all can't keep your order straight either. He was supposed to be the last witness of the day. At 1:30, when we came back from lunch, he was listed as the last witness of the day. And y'all can change it around if you want to, but...
And not only that, Your Honor, but circumstances obviously change and we have to adjust and it's...
Okay. Well, I mean, I cannot help the fact he also, I don't think, was listed on the media email from last Friday.
Your Honor, we're...
Probably because you didn't know that he was going to be a witness this
right,
week.
Right, right. We didn't know that he was going to be a witness. So we're asking, Your Honor, that he not, that his face not be...
Y'all knew he was going to be a witness this morning, and you don't bother to think about, oh, by the way, until he's already here on the stand being filmed.
Your Honor, if the court remembers, the reason that we give a list of a number of witnesses is so that we are not in the position that we will not be in a position like yesterday where the court is admonished that we are not to have no one out there. And so as we arrange and rearrange,
I'm not faulting you for not having him on last week's list because things changed, but I am saying that if you have concerns about a witness being filmed, then please raise it maybe that morning if that's the first you know you're going to call that witness and not after the witness is in the courtroom and has been filmed.
I don't disagree.
Okay, because there is nothing I can do about the fact that he was filmed. So, with regard to further filming of him,
we are asking that he not be further filmed.
Okay.
Please.
And I Thank think you. That given the reason given, that that is reasonable. So I don't have a problem with that. Anybody have a problem with that? Media does not, that are in the courtroom, defense attorneys, nobody has a problem. All right, fantastic. And that, what have we been doing? Just last initial?
No, if, we, with respect to the name, I don't think that we've been concealing the name. We've just not been showing the faces. So I don't, let me make sure about that because.
Well, what is in the order says that anything that displays the name, display first initial, last initial, and says.
Yes, that part.
As well. Okay, and then, but audio is fine, right? Just not the victim, I mean, the witness's face,
right.
Not the witness's name.
Right, thank you.
All righty, so let's stop the filming, get him on the stand.
Yeah, he almost stopped filming on him.
I think so. Beats me.
Thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you will notice that there's a different witness in front of you right now, and I'm going to instruct you at this time you are to disregard the testimony of the last witness, if you'll swear this witness for us.
Yes, I'm Javaria Starks, J-A-R-V-A-R-I-O-U-S. Last name is Starks, S-T-A-R-K-S.
Good afternoon, Detective Starks.
Good afternoon.
Detective Starks, where do you work?
I'm currently employed with the City of Atlanta Police Department.
And how long have you been there?
I've been employed with the City of Atlanta Police Department since 2012.
What is your current position with APD?
I'm currently a detective with the Atlanta Police Department.
Back in November 2020, what was your position?
I was a detective.
What are some of your responsibilities as a detective?
I investigate things such as robberies, homicides, auto thefts, entering autos, burglaries, shoplifting.
And are you post-certified?
I am.
And have you maintained that post-certification throughout your career?
I have.
I want to turn your attention to November 24th, 2020. Now, did you respond to a call at 4275 Walton Crossings, apartment 3216?
Yes, sir, I did.
And is that location in Fullerton County?
Yes, sir.
And what is this location? An apartment, business, what is it?
It's an apartment complex.
And was it a one or two bedroom apartment that you responded to?
I believe it was a one bedroom, one bathroom.
Now, can you orient the jury on why you were called?
Yes. So I responded to the location to assist with a search warrant. The warrant was for a person and for ammunition, guns, and safety devices.
Now, when you responded to the call, were you alone or were you with a partner?
I was transported to the apartment complex with Sergeant Price, and we met other people there, the people who actually executed the warrant and other members of my team.
Do you typically travel with a partner?
Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't.
Now, you mentioned that you were there to aid in the assistance of a search warrant.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So when you arrived at the location, were you assigned to a specific area to search?
When I arrived to this apartment, I started searching around the bedroom and closet area of the apartment.
Why did you search that area?
When I initially came to the apartment, I was escorted in, and they showed me stuff that was already found, so I just started that way.
Did you find anything in the bedroom?
Yes, sir.
And what did you find?
In the closet, I found a rifle. Also located in the closet inside of a shoebox, I found a shoebox with a driver license and passport and other cards that belonged to Chandler Durham.
Do you know who the residents was of this apartment complex?
I believe it was a female. I don't remember her name.
What did you do with the items that you found?
The items that I found, I gave it to Investigator Belknap because he was the lead investigator on the search warrant.
And did you or Belknap prepare the search warrant for that residence?
Investigator Belknap prepared the search warrant.
Did you prepare a report in this case?
No, sir, I did not.
Were you wearing body camera that day?
Yes, sir, I was.
Permission to approach, Your Honor?
You may.
I'm now showing you what's been pre-marked as states 3 Paw Paw and 4 Paw Paw. Take a look at those.
Yes, sir, sir.
Do you recognize those items?
Yes, sir.
And what are they?
It's a rifle that I located in the closet, and the ID of Chandler Durham that I located in the shoebox was with inside of the closet.
Are they a fair and accurate representation of the items depicted on your body cam that day?
Yes, sir.
Your Honor, at this time the state moves to admit 3 Papa Papa and 4 Papa Papa.
All right, those are admitted.
I'm now going to publish 3 Papa Papa. And Detective Starks, what are we, tell the jury what is depicted in 3 Papa Papa?
Yes, sir, it's an ID of Chandler Durham that I located within the shoebox inside of a closet.
And what else was in that shoebox?
A passport, I believe some debit cards, credit cards of Chandler Durham.
You may.
That ID, what was the name on that ID?
I believe it was Chandler Durham.
And what else did you locate or find in that shoebox?
It was a passport and I believe some debit cards.
And did those items bear the name Chandler Durham as well?
Yes.
I'm now going to publish 4 Papa Papa. And Detective Starks, what are we, tell the jury, what are we looking at?
Yes, sir. We're looking at a rifle that was located inside of the apartment closet.
And where was this? I know it was in the closet, but where was this located?
On the shelf, I believe, inside the bedroom closet.
And the items that you found, what did you do with the rifle and the Fox and family identification?
I notified Investigator Badnap, and he took collection of the evidence.
Did you do anything else?
No, sir.
Brief moment, Your Honor.
Detective Starks, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. How you doing, sir?
I'm good. My name is Carrington Matthews, and I represent Mr. Marquavius Huey in these proceedings.
Yes, sir.
You have been a police officer with Atlanta Police Department since 2012?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you were part of a team that conducted a search warrant. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And I understand it was in November 24th or so, 2020, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you were not the only person that was there doing the search warrant, correct?
I was not the only one there. You're correct.
Okay. My understanding is that you did not prepare a report, correct?
You're correct.
Okay. And my understanding is that there were a couple items that you just testified to and you talked about that you located, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. You have arrest powers, right?
Yes.
You have the ability to take out warrants for people when you believe that something awry has happened and a crime has been committed, correct?
Yes.
Can you look at this jury and can you tell them that you took out a warrant for a rifle found at this particular location for Mr. Marquavius Huey?
I did not.
You had the ability to do it, right?
Yes.
You did not.
You're correct, sir.
Okay. Let's talk about the items in the shoebox. The items that you just talked about, you're not aware of any of those items that we just talked about being the result of any crimes that you took out a warrant for on November 24, 2020 for Mr. Marquavius Huey.
I did not take out any warrants dealing with the apartments or contents in the apartments.
You had the ability to take out a warrant if you believe that a crime had occurred with respect to these items that were located in a shoebox, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, this is November 24th or so, 2020. Did you take out any warrants in 2021 for these items that you just talked about?
No.
Did you take out a warrant or anything of that nature in 2022 for the items that you just talked about?
No.
And to this date, you've not taken out any warrants for any items that you found with respect to a rifle located at that location, correct?
You're correct, sir.
And the same would be for the items that you just talked about with respect to the shoebox, correct?
You're correct.
Okay. Now, let's talk about a couple other things. So this would have been a November 24, 2020 search warrant, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you locate a five-star gold ring at this location?
No, sir.
Did you locate a bracelet, a gold bracelet or necklace or anything of that nature that you collected at this location that you believe was part of any type of crime?
No, sir.
Let's talk about, I think in the search warrant, Detective, you talked about a need or desire to look for cellular phone information at that location, correct?
Yes.
All right. Did you locate any cellular phone that would belong to anyone that would be the name Gary Holloman?
I located a cell phone on the couch.
Right.
And I turned it to Investigator Belknap. That's as far as I went with the cell phone. I didn't try to find the owner of the cell phone.
Okay. So there's one cell phone that you said you found. To your knowledge, as you sit here today and you look at this jury, you have no knowledge or information that a cell phone belonged to a Gary Holloman, correct?
I found a cell phone on the couch. I don't know who it belonged to. Okay. And I turned it over to Investigator Belknap.
You have no information or evidence that any cell phone was found owning belonging to a Domitia Coppedge, correct?
You're correct. I don't know who the cell phone belonged to.
Okay. Those are my questions. Thank you, Detective Starks.
Yes, sir.
Any other defense questions? Nope. Okay. Any redirect? Go ahead.
Detective Starks, was this your case?
It was not my case.
Okay. Whose case was it?
Investigator Belknap.
For a search warrant to be valid, does it have to contain information if the evidence of a crime is likely to be found?
Sustained.
What does a search warrant have to contain in order for it to contain evidence that information? Strike that. Let me ask a better question. What does a search warrant have to contain? Does it have to contain information that evidence of a crime is likely to be found at the place to be searched?
Again, Your Honor, that would be a leading question and also foundation.
Sustained.
Detective Starks, did you prepare the search warrant in this case?
I did not.
And as a detective, did you assist Belknap in the preparation of this case?
Objection asked and answered.
Did you assist? I'm sorry, who?
Objection to vague as well.
I'll rephrase it.
Okay.
What additional steps did you take in the execution of the search warrant?
The execution of the search warrant, I searched.
But I'm going to object. This has been asked and answered. Additional steps.
I don't know about additional steps. Overruled.
You may ask. I searched and I advised Investigator Belknap of my findings inside the apartment.
Court's indulgence, Your Honor. No further questions, Your Honor.
All right.